Hi students, today we are going to talk about a clinical examination in medicine, especially cardiovascular system. Okay. First procedure to start examination, we have a synonym, okay, that is we call C pale C. That is a synonym before we start to consider some factors. So what are those C pale C? C stands for concern. We have to ask first concern. Before that, we have to introduce ourselves and we have to ask the permission or consent from the patient to do examination. This P stands for privacy. We have to maintain a patient's privacy. Suppose if we are going to examine a female patient, we have to use a curtains. Or even if we are going to examine a male patient, if he wish to use a curtain, we can use. Or otherwise, when we are going to examine his genitalia, we have to use curtains to maintain his privacy. And A and L stands for adequate light source, and E stands for exposure. Usually, when we do some examination related to cardiovascular or abdomen or respiratory or genitalia, we have some point of exposure. We have to expose adequately. So C stands for chaperone. That is when a female patient, or sorry, when a male patient is going to examine a female patient, we have to ask for a chaperone. That is very important. At the same time, when a female person going to examine a male patient, we can ask for a male chaperone. It's a very, very important to do our examination. Now we see some examine routine. First, introduce yourself and take concern. As I told you, that is coming under concern. We have to introduce ourselves and we have to take the concern. Second one is ensure the adequate exposure and request for a chaperone if necessary. Proper positioning of the patient at 45 degrees. In case of cardiovascular examination, usually we place the patient in a 45 degrees propped up. Comment on the general appearance of the patient, especially whether he or she is dyspneic or propped up or ill looking. We have to comment. And look at the surroundings. We can observe the surroundings to see is there any IV cannula or antibiotics or nebulization mask or nebulization cylinder or any monitoring instruments. We have to observe it, because that itself can give us a information regarding what problem or what disease he is having. And finally, we are going to do start with this general examination. Okay. General examination related to cardiovascular system. Before we go into the precordium examination, we usually start with general examination related to cardiovascular system. So what are those general examinations? First, we have to see for appearance. His appearance, whether he is ill looking or well looking, whether he is wasted or whether he is a dyspneic, or whether he is in propped up position, or such as we have to see his appearance all over the body, whether he is yellow, is discoloration of the body, or whether the patient is pale. So these are the thing important. Then body build, where we have to see whether he is well nutrited patient, or whether he has wasting or some kind of problems. And cooperative, we have to mention the patient is very cooperative or non-cooperative. Then decubitus mean in what position is favorable to the patient, that is decubitus. And we have to check febrile or not, because it infective endocarditis, that is a heart problem. So in this case, the patient may present with a fever, so that's why we check febrile or not. And cyanosis, that is also very important. And check for Marfanoid features. So Marfanoid features, what are those Marfanoid features? We can see elongated head, subluxation of lens, retinal detachment, long fingers, high arch palate. Why we consider about these Marfanoid features? In Marfanoid features, there are one heart problem, that is, we can say aortic dissection, that is, that can happen. So that can happen in case of Marfan syndrome people. Then conjunctiva to see the anemia as well as dental hygiene. This is also very important in case of infective endocarditis patients. Then fingers and toe for clubbing. Peripheral stigma of infective endocarditis. Here we have to see is there any splinter hemorrhages or Janeway lesions or sless knots. These are the peripheral stigma of infective endocarditis. So when we check, we do a general examination, we have to observe for this angle or sacral edema. That is obvious in case of angle edema. We can see in case of heart failure patients, and also sacral edema also we can see in case of heart failure patient. Why? Because severe heart failure patients, they cannot walk or they cannot move. So when they are in sitting position or on the lying position, sacral edema may develop. See some peripheral features of aortic regurgitation. So what are these peripheral features? We can see a Corrigan sign. That mean, what do you mean by Corrigan sign? Is there are both side of the neck we see carotid artery. So carotid artery, it is pulsatile. And the other side, JVP, jugular venous pulse, okay, that pulse is not a pulse, that is visible, we cannot palpate that. But in case of carotid artery pulsation, that is also visible, but we can palpate. But in case of Corrigan sign, what will happen? We can see a visible carotid artery pulse. It will act like a dancing. We can see carotid artery move here and there in case of Corrigan sign. What is head nodding? The patient's head will go down and up. That is called head nodding. And Squinsky sign. What is the Squinsky sign? Is when we ask the patient to show his finger and there's a nail in the middle part of the nail, we have to give a compression. When we give a compression, we see a line that appears as a white and red. So red line that will move here up and down, move here and there, that is known as a Quincy sign. And also we can see pupil for argyrobacterium people, which seen in syphilis. As syphilis, it is a cause of aortic regurgitation. So that's why we see this. So now general examination finish. But before we go to precordium, we have to consider about three important examination that is also coming under general examination. But in case of cardiovascular examination, we give very important for those three. That's why we just a little bit separate from the general examination. So what are the very first important thing is pulse. We have to check the pulse and we have to comment about the radial pulse and its beat and the rhythm and the character. Everything we have to comment. Then after checking the radial pulse, we have to check for is there any radio relay by checking the opposite hand's radial pulse together. And then we have to go for femoral pulse and we have to see the character of the femoral pulse. And after that we have to check is there any radio femoral delay. By checking the radial pulse and the femoral pulse together, we can see is there any delay, and we can go for the peripheral pulses such as anterior tibialis, posterior tibialis and dorsalis pedis. Then after that we have to measure the JVP. In my coming lectures I will explain you how to measure this JVP. And the third one is we have to offer BP measuring. We have to offer we don't need to do at first. We have to offer the examiners. I would like to measure his BP. When examiner say yes, we can measure. Then inspection. What are the things we have to inspect regarding the cardiovascular examination? First, we are going to examine the chest, isn't it? So first we have to look for is there any chest deformities such as pectum excavatum, pectum carinatum, and is there any barrel shape chest? Or any deformities we have to check. Then surgical scars, especially the midline So scars and left thoracotomy scars we have to check. Then look for visible pulsations of a chest wall. It may be visible apex beat or it may be visible threads like that. Then we go for palpation. Palpation, we have to check the apex beat. Okay, what do we do here? We have to palpate for apex beat and comment on position of the apex beat and whether it is displayed or not, and also comment on the character of the apex beat. Usually we ask, we just palpate from the 7th or 8th intercostal space and we come up. Suppose if I am palpating from the 7th intercostal space, I've just come up 6th and 5th. So in that place we may feel the apex beat. Suppose if we are unable to palpate the apex beat in case of a fat person or in case of any conditions, we just can ask the patient to turn left side and again we can palpate in that way. And we have to comment about the apex beat. In case of mitral stenosis, that apex beat will be tapping apex beat, that is the character. In case of aortic stenosis, that will be a heaving apex beat, that is the character. In case of mitral regurgitation, the apex beat will be deviated. So these are very important diseases regarding the valvular diseases of heart and also the character of the apex beat. Palpate for threads of the pericardium. If there is murmur, sometimes we can even palpate the threads. Palpate for a left parasternal heave, which is indicative of right ventricular hypertrophy. And look for a palpable second heart sound in the pulmonary area, which is suggestive of pulmonary hypertension. That's very important. And finally, palpate for carotid threads over the carotid artery. Okay, now here in case of pericardium examination, there is no percussion. So we directly go to the auscultation. Auscultations, there are four auscultating areas in the chest that we should know about them. Okay, so what are those four auscultating areas? We'll see. I have put a picture from here, you can learn. These, the red color, the green and the blue and the yellow, these four are the auscultating areas of the chest for the heart. The red one, we call it, that's an apex area, that is indicating for mitral valve. The green one, that is the area of tricuspid valve, we say that is the left sternal border or left lower sternal border. And the other two areas are right second intercostal space and the left second intercostal space. The right second intercostal space indicating aortic valve and the left intercostal space indicating for pulmonary valve. First, auscultate in all four areas with palpating the carotid artery and consider the sound 1 and sound 2. Then listen for any murmurs and decide the murmurs based in the following points. Okay, it's very important. And also always remember to show examiner that you are timing the number by palpating the carotid pulse. First, when you hear a murmur, we have to consider whether it is systolic or diastolic. Second, the location where the murmur is best heard. Third one, the grade of the murmur. In case of next lecture will be about murmurs only. So in there I will explain how to diagnose a murmur, how to grade murmur, and radiation of the murmur. It's very important in case of diagnosis. And the effect of the respiration, this is very, very important. The effect of the respiration on the murmur. Remember that the intensity of all right-sided murmurs increase with inspiration. And the intensity of the left-sided murmur are increased with expiration. Never ever forget this in your whole life. This will help you to diagnose most of the cases. Okay. Listen to the heart sound first and comment on any abnormality and check with carotid pulse or auscultation in all four areas, as I said previously. And remember to demonstrate auscultation in mitral area. Now I'm going to talk about all four areas, okay? Remember to demonstrate auscultation in mitral area with a bell and the patient in the left lateral position for murmur of mitral stenosis. So this is a procedure you are going to auscultate for the mitral stenosis murmur. How? We have to auscultate by the bell and ask the patient to turn left. So leptate is positioned for murmur of mitral stenosis. So what is the murmur of mitral stenosis? That we call mid-diastolic murmur. Okay, I will explain in my next lecture about each and everything about the murmur. So see, this is the pattern. Left at the position, we have to auscultate. Next, examine the patient seated and leaning forward with the breath held in expiration for the murmur of aortic regurgitations. Why we do aortic regurgitation? This position on expiration? Because aortic regurgitation, aorta is coming from the left side. Okay, so so that's why we ask the patient to hold the breath on expiration, breath held in expiration. So here, in case of aortic regurgitation, what is the murmur? That is early diastolic murmur. Okay. Early diastolic murmur. So this is the picture you see here. This is the position to auscultate for aortic regurgitation. And auscultate in mitral area when patient's lying on the bed, and move the stethoscope towards the axilla to demonstrate the mitral regurgitation murmur. Because in case of mitral regurgitation, the murmur will be we can hear in the mitral area, but when we move the stethoscope towards the axilla, we can hear the radiating part of the murmur. So that murmur is a pan-systolic murmur. So that will help you in case of mitral regurgitation diagnosis. Auscultate in aortic area for aortic stenosis murmur, and auscultate in pulmonary area for pulmonary stenosis murmur. So here you can see this is the area, the yellow color one I have pointed, aortic stenosis murmur we can hear. What is the murmur we hear is ejection systolic murmur. And same here, pulmonary stenosis murmur, and the blue color one, what is the murmur here? We see ejection systolic murmur, same murmurs in both sides. Sometimes these murmurs can radiate to the carotid area that we can hear. So ask permission to examine a liver and lung basis for evidence of cardiac failure. Then retest. If the examiner give permission to examine, you can examine. Otherwise, redress the patients or help him to dress. And say thank you to the patient. That's very, very important. We have to be gentle towards the patient. Thank you. And please don't forget to subscribe and like and comment. Thank you.